boxes to click might be nice, but toggle switches give so many more cool styling options. We are going to create the basic toggle in this video, which is going to fit into nearly every project by default, and we will make sure it works neatly inside a toggle group. In the next video, we will have a look at how we can style the toggles with neat effects. Luckily, a lot of the heavy lifting of this switch can be done by a component already built into Unity, the UI slider. Get rid of the fill area since we don't need it. Our code will handle any further setup by itself, so that in the future we can just drag our script onto a slider and don't have to tinker through menus and settings ourselves. Call your new script toggle switch. It needs the iPointer click handler interface so we can have it react to clicks on it. Ignore the red squiggly you probably got for now, we'll come to it in a moment. We'll start with the slider value and make sure it's always between 0 and 1 by utilizing the range attribute. We add the current value and of course we need a reference to our slider itself. For the animation section, we need a duration somewhere between no animation and maybe a second or so. A second works well for testing or very dramatic changes, but seeing as this should just be a quick switch, I highly recommend not going over half a second. To avoid a simple linear interpolation from start to end, we can add some easing to it, using an animation curve. Using ease in out provides a nice effect, but you can customize it according to your preferences. Just ensure that the starting point to the left is lower than the end point to the right. Also, we need a coroutine at some point, which we will store in here. Depending on whether things are toggled on off, we might want to notify other scripts or objects. We can handle this easily with two Unity events, one for when the value is set to true and another for when it is set to false. We will store references to the toggle switch group manager here in case we need it. Onwards to the setup methods. OnValidate will get called whenever we make a change in the inspector, so we can set everything up here to test. In case our slider has not yet been assigned, we call the setup slider component first. The code retrieves the slider component from the game object. In case it can't be found, we get notified. We set the slider to be non-interactable to prevent any user interaction with a true/false toggle. For example, in case we don't set it like this, our users can just click and slide, messing up the reason to have a toggle switch in the first place. Since Unity typically grays out uninteractable elements, we set the disabled color property to white and disable the transition mode by setting it to none. We will also need a simple setup method to call from our group manager. Alright, setup is done. We call the setup and start once more to make sure everything's working as intended, and we need a method called onPointerClick with this parameter. That's the method iPointerClickHandler demanded from us to implement, and it will handle clicks on the game object this script is attached to. Toggle handles which kind of toggling needs to occur. In case we have a manager, we will use the toggle method from there. Otherwise, we will use setState and startAnimation directly from here. By assigning it in the negative current value, we can toggle between true and false with each call of the method. Toggle by group manager will handle this switching logic in a moment in case we utilize this manager. This method first sets the state, invokes the event according to the value, stops a potentially running coroutine, and starts a new one at its end. We invoke the events before we even start the animation, because the animation is, in all honesty, eye candy. If we have a toggle to set music to enabled or disabled, we as players want the change to happen immediately, after all. This is also a reason why I'd recommend not having an animation duration of more than half a second. Up comes the sliding animation. To start, we need to obtain the start and end values. The starting value can be retrieved directly from the slider itself, while the end value is determined by our current value. If the current value is true, the end value is set to 1, otherwise it is set to 0. We create a float called time, and if our duration is longer than 0, we enter a while loop that continues as long as the value of time is less than the animation duration. Within this loop, we perform the following steps. We increment the value of time by time delta time. Calculate the lerp factor based on our animation curve. This gives our slider transition a smooth easing effect. Use the lerp factor to interpolate the slider value towards the end value. And use yield return null to wait for a frame before starting the next iteration of the while loop. Finally, we set the slider value to the end value. And before testing, create a rudimentary toggle switch group manager like this, so you won't get errors because of the toggle switch group manager reference or the toggle group method. First test. Depending on your animation curve, you will have a nicely animating toggle switch at this point. You can of course also reposition and resize every element of the slider itself. And if this tutorial is helpful to you, please give it a like to let me know. And subscribe if you enjoy UI tutorials. Let's finish up the manager logic in case we have multiple toggle switches to manage and only ever want one to be toggled on. We can set an initial toggle switch that will be toggled on at the beginning. We use a bool to check if all sliders can be toggled off, and a list to keep track of the toggle switches registered to this manager. In awake, we get all the toggle switches and child elements and register them to our list. In start, we are checking each button in toggle switches. If the current value of any toggle is true, which means the toggle is on, the value "are all toggled off" becomes false and the loop breaks. This logic essentially states that if not all toggles are off, or if it is valid for all toggles to be off, there is no need to proceed to the next part. Depending on if we set something as our initial switch, we call the toggleByGroupManager method of the setOne, or just the first in the list. Be aware, the first entry might not be the first child element of this manager. Next, we'll fill out the toggle group. If there is less or equal to one switch in the group, return. In case they can all be toggled off and the slider that called this method is set to true, we will toggle all the sliders to false. Otherwise, we will toggle the clicked switch to true and all others to false. Now we can correctly toggle on and off our switches. If they can all be set to off, the behavior is hopefully clear. But otherwise, the previous true toggled slider will reset to false when another slider gets clicked. In the next video, I will show how we can further customize the look of this element. But until then, here's a video YouTube thinks you might be interested in.